Good morning, people of God. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ on this day where we gather in remembrance and to give thanks to God for the lift of the life of Betty, who is a blessing to so many. And you got to see, many of us didn't know her back in those days. I never got to meet Ralph, so I got to meet Ralph a little bit as well as in the photos today. We thank you for that. But we come to celebrate her as a friend, as a neighbor, as family, and to support the family with our presence and our prayers as well. We're glad you could be here today on behalf of the family. Thank you for your presence. I want to give you a couple of words of instruction for those who are newcomers here. The first is, as you come here at the end of the service, there is a time of fellowship and food, a luncheon provided. It'll be down in the fellowship hall. Everyone is welcome to that. We hope you'll stay. It's a good time for you to share your stories, memories of Betty with the family, and just to spend time with them in support as well. Also, when it comes time to communion, for Holy Communion in this service, this is not Hope's table and it's not a Lutheran table. This is the Lord's table of grace and all of God's children are welcome. And we hope you'll participate in communion if you feel so led. We do take communion by intinction, which means that a piece of the host will be handed to you that you can then dip in the cup. And if you have a special need for alcohol-free or gluten-free, if you come up and let us know that when you arrive, we have that available as well. Also in the bulletin, as we follow through the order of worship, you will note the spaces that are in the bold black print, which is the part for the congregation to participate vocally in the service, as well as the 23rd Psalm, which I will invite you to read with me if it does good for your heart to do so. And also, as we work through the service, a reminder, we will be remaining seated for the entirety of the service until the final part of the service when we have the closing hymn, where we will stand. I'll be leading the family out during that time, and you will stay and then be released after that so they can have some time to get situated down to the dinner before you arrive. And we appreciate your patience in that. We begin the inside of our bulletin. We gather this day to worship and to give thanks to God for the gift of a very special life of Betty O'Neill, and to give thanks to God for the gift of another special life, the gift of his son, Jesus Christ, through whom Betty and we all have resurrection victory. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all of our sorrows with the consolation we receive from God, that we might then comfort others in their sorrows with the same consolation. Thanks be to God. When we are baptized into Christ Jesus, we are baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his.
Bear you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Betty. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console those who mourn. Give us your aid so that we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes to us from the prophet Isaiah, the 40th chapter. Hear the words of the Lord. Have you not known and have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the end of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary, and his understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and he strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. There are perhaps no other words that are more well known on a day such as this than are found in the 23rd Psalm, penned, we believe, by King David when he was still but a boy, remembering what it was to be a shepherd. As I read these words, if it does your heart good, feel free to join me in the reading. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our gospel lesson comes to us from the gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter. Hear the words of Christ. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God and believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I tell you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, then I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, who the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, and my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled. And do not let them be afraid. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God endures forever. Amen. Let us pray. Now speak, Lord, in this moment, while we wait on thee, and hush our hearts to listen with expectancy. Amen. There's a story about a Roman commander of troops who was once in a place they didn't know well, marching into battle, and he marched in a direction and got lost in the battle and found himself in a place where when he looked at the map, it was not listed on the map. In fact, it was in that space where the map makers had left monsters and things and dragons in the corner, and he wrote back looking for his commanders back of the encampment to give him direction. And this is the note he sent. Please send new orders. We have marched off the map. I think we find ourselves in a bit of a situation like that today. We find ourselves in a place where we know where we have been. but we're not necessarily sure how to navigate where we are, or to come out of grief and out of suffering or out of loss and to find some way to make headway that makes sense to us. We know what the world tells us. We know that there are things that are standardized that we do to try to help, but we wonder really where we are headed from here, and not just in these days, but our future eternally. We feel sometimes like we've marched off the map of life, and we just need a little direction and a little help. Perhaps the best way is to start by remembering where we've already been, what has brought us up to this point so far, what are the kind of hallmarks or the waypoints of life that we can look to. We especially look at that in Betty's life. Born in, I hope I say this right, Shamokin, Pennsylvania. See, I'm from Florida, and we have Southern accent. We don't always say things correctly from up north. Shamokin, Pennsylvania, 1926. That's a long time ago, folks. It was the time before the Great Depression. We were just talking before the service with some folks in the back about all the things she's seen happen in the world that have changed. Think back to that, all the things that have changed since those years. You know, flight, people taking flight was relatively new back in those days. You didn't think a lot about flying in planes, and we got to a point where we have space shuttle flights that happened so often when they did that they became kind of secondhand. We didn't talk about them that much. The idea of being able to call someone on a phone, the newness of that, and now we text and do things so instantly, and if you have to send a fax, by God, it seems to take forever to send a fax to someone. Things have changed so much in the years that she was alive. And yet there are parts of her life that never changed that we're grateful for. She faced at an early age a difficult time in our society. The Great Depression came. It was not a good time for a lot of people. There was a lot of hurt. There was a lot of loss, a lot of fear. There was not a lot of hope in the world. But young children are so filled with hope, aren't they? It just seems to be a part of their nature to look forward to a future. And she certainly had that. Betty was filled with the exuberance and the joy that children can have. She found pleasure in the simple things of life. She loved to sing, and she loved to dance. I know some of you love dancing as well. Some also love singing as well. She loved those parts of life. She loved to sit on the front stoop with her mother and sing, and not just sing the good old hymns and the good old songs they knew so well from the past, but to sing them together and even sing them in harmony. She loved that, and I think that says something of her life. She loved living life with those she loved in harmony. It doesn't mean you have to always be on the same note and do the same things and be of the same mind with others, but you live together and you encourage each other in such a way that it makes beautiful music in life. She learned that early on, and it's the way she lived throughout her life. She also learned, because of necessity, the value of hard work at a very young age. She began doing things like setting hair. I had to look up what setting hair was, but doing the lady's hair in the neighborhood. She'd go around and do the curlers and do those things for a quarter, which I think prices might have gone up a little bit since back then. But we'd do it for all the ladies on Saturdays in the neighborhood. She would do those things. She worked other jobs as well, and she entered the workforce after the eighth grade. She worked in a lot of fields throughout her life, not only doing those odd jobs like that in the neighborhood, but working in a factory, most likely a sewing factory in that area, and department store, and she was a waitress for many years. But in all the places she worked with other people, and she often engaged in service kind of work with other people. It was a part of who she was. She loved the dialogue and the interaction with those around her, as many of you know, neighbors and friends, how she touched your lives. She had a wit and a winsomeness, and had a good sense of humor as well, as I learned, hearing some of the stories of some of her favorite sayings. She had a wonderful sense about her in that way, and was a blessing these many years to so many because of that. As much as she offered to the people she worked with, as much as she offered to you, friends and neighbors, she saved the very best of herself for her family. She met Ralph as he mustered out of the Army back after World War II, and they got married pretty quickly. She was very young when they got married, and they were still settling in to figure out what it means to be a married couple. I mean, it takes a lot of work. Sometimes we think we know what we're doing until we get married, and we realize we don't know much of anything in those days. And they were settling in and making a home and trying to figure out how life would move forward. And about a year later, well, everything changed, didn't it? That's when Peggy was born. And when you become a mom, everything changes. I'll share with you what my father shared with us when we had our first child. He pulled me aside just after our son was born in a hallway of the hospital. And he said, "Son, do you want me to tell you the secret of what it means to be a parent?" And at that point, after my father had not seemed wise for years, because I'm an adult now, suddenly I wanted everything he could share with me. I said, what does it mean? He said, it means for the rest of your life, your heart will walk around outside your body. That's what it means. Life changes when children come, and it changed for the better for her. She loved being a mom. She really, really did. And Rob, when you came, it just expanded the love and expanded the warmth in the household. There was a joy there and a sharing that was so wonderful. And they worked hard to provide a good home for you. They both worked very hard. Your dad, multiple jobs at a time to make sure you're provided for and to teach you what it was to be a woman and how to grow and be strong in yourself and depend on yourself. And she was the disciplinarian. Now, I have a hard time believing that, having met her, but maybe you guys won't have such a hard time remembering it. But I can't imagine that. Now, I never knew Ralph, though, to understand that, but it's hard for me to picture her being a disciplinarian. She was always so bubbly when I knew her. But I can see by your faces, she was a good one. But then again, she was always a bit of a firecracker, wasn't she? She had a wonderful wit and winsomeness, but she also knew what she wanted and what she liked, and by God, it was going to happen at some point. She loved decorating. She loved having a beautiful home that was kept just so, something that was passed on to the two of you. And she loved the house being a place that was warm and inviting and was comfortable and was beautiful. It very much reflected her personality and who she was as a person. But she also liked to change things. She might paint on a whim when people were away and change the color of her room. Or there's that time she wanted that hole in the wall, that place to do curios and things, to go through from the dining room to the kitchen, I believe it was. And she had this plan, and she told Ralph, and Ralph was just kind of, you know, like some guys are as husbands, I'm not going to look over there right now, kind of say, oh, I'll get around to it, and it doesn't really happen. So he came home one day, and she'd taken a hammer and knocked down the wall herself. He kind of had to fix it and do what she wanted at that point. She was that kind of firecracker. You know, she lived a life that was loving and that she poured herself into others. Most of us learned that when they moved here to the Villages after retirement. She loved the Villages. It just came alive in her, this joy she had at being with people. I loved seeing her where she was playing golf. We saw the pictures of her loving being out in the sun and in the sand. She just loved doing things, but she especially loved doing them with the people she enjoyed. Being with family in those moments, being with friends, finding neighbors who weren't just neighbors from another place, but became family to her. Wednesdays were always a special treat with the ladies who would go out with her. She looked forward to those days, even towards the end. She looked forward to the days that you'll go out on adventures. It might be to dinner, it might be to the movies, it might be going somewhere else. She looked forward to it so very much. I said to some of you when I saw you that day, it was a gift that you gave her that was so very precious to her, especially after Ralph's passing. But I know you did it also and received so much from her as well. And the gift of friendship and the joy of sharing life together. And of course, there's family. Those of you that shared all that time with her got to hear about the family quite a bit. She was so proud of her family. Not just of her girls, but of Scott and Sean and Allison, if you can hear us on the internet as well. You all are more than grandchildren. I hope you know that. You share more than her blood. You're a living legacy. You share within your lives the lessons and things passed down and the hallmarks and traits of family that are passed down that you give to your children and will continue on so that children to come who never have known Betty, because they know you, will know something of her and be blessed by it. And that can be said for all of us here. Each one of us carries a bit of Betty around in our hearts. The question is, how much of that shows? How much do we share with other people? And I pray after this day, it'll be more and more. And we come to this day. We come to this day where we wonder how we move on from this day. We wonder if there's any place to find some wisdom now that we look back and we are so grateful and we have such joyous memories, and yet the presence of her absence follows us in this day to a place where we hurt and we long for her presence and we want to know what is to come. We're not the first people to face a day like this. Someone else, many, many years ago, facing a very similar day, wrote some words that we call the 23rd Psalm. And I think it gives us good direction for this day. David, the innocent little shepherd boy, knew the truth of what it was to be a shepherd that had to get through the difficulties and dangers of life when there are things that could be lurking around every corner. There was no if about the reality of loss and of pain and of hardship. It wasn't an if, it was a when. And the 23rd Psalm candidly faces the inevitable. It proclaims that not if we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, but that we will do it. Life isn't all about loaded tables and overflowing cups and green pastures. Sometimes our hair isn't anointed with oil. It is grimy and sweaty. Sometimes we're not resting in green pastures. We're struggling up the seemingly insurmountable hills around us. And sometimes we're not resting on the shore of quiet waters. Sometimes we're struggling to make it through the valley. And that's where we find ourselves today. We find ourselves in the midst of the valley. It's not something we can run through. It's not something where we can rush the experience. We have to experience on some level. But I love the word through. It's so easy to pass by that word in the passage of Scripture. It doesn't say we're stuck in the valley. It doesn't say we dwell in the valley. As we go through the valley, God does not intend this to be a place we remain. It's a place we come to and we recognize and we move past, not only in the way we experience it in Betty's death, but in the way we experience the thoughts of our own death as well. That we're to move forward to the other side. And this valley, the hills of life and of death and of aging that cast those shadows, and infirmity sometimes that cast the shadows. Sometimes we walk in the shadow before we ever get to the valley, and sometimes the shadow goes just past the valley. And yet we're called to walk through it and find comfort with the fact that we don't walk through the valley alone. There's one that has tread that same path himself and came out the other side and rose victorious but returns to guide us through as well. And we give thanks that Christ our Lord promises that he will never leave us nor forsake us, even to the end of the age, that he's gone, prepared a place for Betty and for us, and comes back to take us to himself. I also find comfort in the fact that we're not wandering this valley alone today. We are surrounded by those gathered here with us, by a kind of flock of sheep here today, and those who couldn't be here with us physically, but who are here with us in heart and mind and spirit. It's a blessing to know that the one who laid down his life for us is still with us and calls us to be together on the journey. But what do we know of what comes after this? What do we know about what is to come? How can we be sure beyond a promise of God, which we should certainly trust in this day? James Weldon Johnson, a famous pastor, wrote a poem about this. He actually wrote it as a funeral message for a woman up in a Yamashita, Georgia, years and years and years ago, but it is one that's become meaningful to me. I've changed the wording a bit to fit Betty's life, but I want to share this poem with you even now. The poem is called Go Down, Death. Weep not, she is not dead. She is resting in the bosom of Jesus. Heartbroken daughters, weep no more. Grief-stricken grandchildren, weep no more. Left lonesome friends, weep no more. She has only just gone home. Just the other day, God was looking down from his great high heaven, looking down on all of his children, and his eyes fell upon Sister Betty, lying there on her bed. And God's big heart was touched with pity, with an everlasting pity. And God sat back on his throne, and he commanded that tall, bright angel that stood at his right hand, call me death. And that tall, bright angel cried out in a voice that broke like a clap of thunder, call death, call death. And the echo sounded down the streets of heaven till it reached away back to that shadowy place where death waits with his pale white horses. And death heard the summons, and he leapt upon his fastest horse, pale as a sheet in the moonlight. Up the golden street, death galloped, and the hooves of his horse struck fire from the gold, but they didn't make a sound. Up death rode to the great white throne and waited for God's command. And God said, go down, death. Go down and find me, Sister Betty. She has borne the heat of the day, and she has labored long in my vineyard, and she's tired, and she's weary. Go down, death, and bring her to me. And death didn't say a word, but he loosed the reins of his pale white horse, and he clamped his spurs to his bloodless sides, and out and down he rode through heaven's pearly gates, past suns and moons and stars on death rode, leaving lightning flashing behind him. Straight down he came. And there he found her lying in her bed. She turned her eyes and she looked and saw what we could never see. She saw old death coming. She saw him coming like a falling star. But death didn't frighten Sister Betty. He looked to her as a welcome friend. And death took her up like a baby and she lay in his icy arms, but she didn't feel a chill. And death began to ride again, up beyond the evening star, into the glittering light of glory, onto the great white throne. As Ralph and others who have been waiting for her looked on in silence, there death laid Sister Betty on the loving breast of Jesus. And Jesus took his own hand, he wiped away her tears, and he smoothed the furrows from her face. And the angel sang a little song. And Jesus rocked her in his arms and kept saying, "Take your rest, take your rest. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Take your rest. Weep not, for she is not dead. She is home and resting in the bosom of Jesus." Almighty God, as we come before you this day, grant us the grace we need. Grace that in our pain we might find comfort, in our sorrow hope, and in our death resurrection. For the sake of Christ, our Lord, and our Redeemer. Amen.
I come to the garden.
Our service continues as we proclaim our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Hear us, Lord. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to the newness of life, and that through the grave and gate of death we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Hear us, Lord. Give courage and faith to all who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope and in joyful expectation. Hear us, Lord. Grant us grace to entrust Betty to your never-failing love, which sustained her in this life. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, and remember her according to the favor you bear for your people. Hear us, Lord. Eternal God, you gave Betty a new birth in baptism and entrusted her to us for a time. As we thank you for the life we shared with her, help us now to release her to your mighty keeping. Bring us all to that day when we shall stand in your presence with all of your saints in light eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus first took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, for this is my body which is broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after the supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." As a community, let us speak together the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Share in the inheritance of all the saints. Come to the table prepared for you. All the Lord's people are welcome. We give you thanks, shepherding God, that you have gathered your scattered flock again this day, feeding us richly with the food of paradise. Accompany us as we serve you all the days of our lives, and gather us with the saints in the day of our death, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord. Amen. There's a poem that the family found that I believe is a word to us from Betty this day that I would like to share with you. It's entitled A Letter from Heaven. When tomorrow starts without me and I'm not there to see, if the sun should rise and find you, your eyes filled with tears for me, I wish so much you wouldn't cry the way you did today, while thinking of the many things we didn't get to say. I know how much you love me, as much as I love you, and each time you think of me, I know you'll miss me too. When tomorrow starts without me, don't think we're far apart, for every time you think of me, I'm right there in your heart. In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God his child, Betty O'Neill, and we commit her body to its final resting place. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face shine on her and be gracious unto her. The Lord look upon her with grace and favor and give her peace this day and forevermore. Amen. I'd like to thank you again on behalf of the family for being here with them this day, and I know you'll be with them through the days that are to come to continue to support them, and remind you that you're invited to join them for a time of food and fellowship down at the other end of the church. Would you stand where you are for the benediction and for the closing hymn? And now may the grace, mercy, and peace of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit abide in your hearts and your homes this day, this week, and forevermore, world without end. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shine.